the name of Jesus that is beautiful and wonderful and powerful. That name that should be the focus of every day, but especially this season. The season in which we remember and celebrate His birth. And that birth was the beginning of a lifetime that led to cross and ultimately to an empty tomb and to hope for me and for each one here and for anyone who has ever lived. And Lord, I pray that we would have fun at Christmas and celebrate, and that we would wear awful jackets and ugly sweaters, and we would have fun with that. But Lord, at the core of that, at the foundation of that, we would recognize it's about Jesus. And that we would wrestle with the question, how do we feel when it's our birthday and nobody remembers us? This is a time to celebrate the birth of the Savior. And I pray that all our attention and all our focus is on Him and His beautiful, wonderful, powerful name and the salvation He provides. And so, Lord, we give this time to You to do with as You see fit. Speak to us, Lord. Give us ears that are open, minds to receive, hearts full of faith. Do with us as You see fit. Speak, for we, Your servants, are listening. In the name of Jesus, we all pray. Amen. In Providence, Rhode Island, there is a judge who hands out sentences in a very unique way and does things differently than other judges do. His name is Frank Caprio, and he has been on the bench in Providence for some 32 years. And the way in which he hands down sentences is so unique and so different that he has become the subject of a local TV show that airs six nights a week in Providence. It's gone viral, right? You can Google Frank Caprio and you will find his story. And the reason his story is so unique is because he, over the course of his years, has canceled hundreds and hundreds of fines and sentences that people should have received. He has not handed out. Costing Providence, the county, whatever, the city, thousands and thousands of dollars in fines that they should have received, but he said no. One case was a woman in which he forgave $400 in parking fines. Now, to us, maybe that doesn't seem like such a big deal until he got to know the story of this woman. This woman was suffering because her son had just been murdered. She was dealing with his loss. She was hurting. And Judge Caprio heard her, felt that pain, felt that hurt, and he did not sentence her and waive the fine, giving her a second chance because he felt compassion for her. And she says, that put my life back on track. When asked why he does this, why he passes judgment like this or not like this, he says, if it's a close call, I give the benefit of the doubt. In actuality, if you read his story, or if you hear the thought behind his story, what you're seeing is that he, as a judge, is passing out mercy. Practicing mercy for those who have done something wrong. Giving something those who have done wrong don't deserve. Right? Even though that woman was suffering a loss, she still had racked up $400 in parking fines that she still owed. So he's giving them something they don't deserve. In the song we've been looking at this Christmas season, The God Who Stays, the writer of the song, Matthew West, speaking to God, he says this. It's up on the screen, it will be. He says, if I were you, I would have turned around and walked away. Right? He's looking up at God. He's saying, God, if I was you and you look down on me, he said, I would turn around and said, guys, I gotta leave that guy alone. He's so screwed up. Because it goes on and says, I would have labeled me beyond repair because I feel like I'm beyond repair. He says, God, if I were you, I would have seen how broken I am, and I would have just gone the other way. Done something different, focused on someone else. Unfortunately, there are so many people who can resonate with those words, who feel broken, who feel beyond repair, because of what they've done or not done, because of how they've treated people or because of how they've been treated, because of choices that they have made, because of decisions they have passed down, they have caused great harm, and now they're living in the consequences of that. And so because of all of that, they think that all they deserve is to live in the shambles, that their life isn't worth being fixed, that they're destined just to live in that pain and that hurt and in those outcomes. They are not fixable. But the good news of Christmas, the good news of Jesus' birth, what we find at this time of year is that God looked down from heaven and he saw your brokenness. He saw your need of repair. In fact, he saw that you were beyond repair. And so what did he do? He sent Jesus. And what does he do? He says, I'm not going to fix you. He says, I'm going to make you new. I'm going to go above and I'm going to go beyond. I'm not just going to patch the leak. I'm going to give you new tires. I'm going to make you new. I'm not just going to patch the plumbing hole in the pipe. I'm going to put in new pipes. He makes us new. The story of Christmas is a story about the mercy of God. Throughout Scripture, we are told that God is a merciful God. Throughout Scripture, we see story after story of the mercy of God. If you want to, open your Bibles or your Bible app and turn to Luke chapter 1. We're going to read verses 67 to 79. It's just a jumping off point for us as we talk about this idea of mercy. A little of the backstory of what we're going to read. You may have a little subtitle that says this is Zechariah's song. Who the heck is Zechariah and why is he singing? Zechariah was a priest of Israel. And he had been chosen to go into the temple and to light incense. It was a very prestigious thing. It usually only happened once in the lifetime of a priest. And Zechariah's number came up, and so he goes into the temple. And as he's in there lighting the incense, an angel appears, Gabriel, standing in front of him. And he says to Zechariah, Zechariah, you are going to have a son. That son we know of as John the Baptist. The interesting thing is, the story behind the story is that Zechariah and his wife have been praying and praying and praying for a child for years and years and years and years, and God chose not to answer that prayer. Now as Zechariah is in the temple, he is an old man. And he would not say this to her face, but his wife Elizabeth is an old woman. Well beyond childbearing years, and now the angel Gabriel stands there and says, you will have son. And as I probably would, as you perhaps would, Zechariah doubted what the angel had to say. Did not believe him. And so because of that, the angel said, Zechariah, because of your doubt, you will not speak until the child is born. As we come to verse 67 of chapter 1 of Luke, what we find is the baby has been born. John the Baptist is now there in his mother's arms. And Zechariah, as they would say in that time, his tongue has been loosed. And he's now able to speak. And he has announced to everybody that the baby's name is John. And then the next thing he does is he sings this song of praise to his God. And here's what he says. His father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come to his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he said through his holy prophets of long ago. Salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors and to remember his holy covenant, the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to rescue us from the hand of our enemies and to enable us to serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, my child, will be called a prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare the way for him, to give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins. 78. Because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet in the path of peace." Zechariah, 9 months without speaking, doubting God, he now comes as he sees his son and says, and speaks of, sings about, praises God for the tender mercy of God. Mercy is a word that we probably don't think we use a lot, but we use it more than we, right? If we were to take stock of our vocabulary, we probably use it more than we think. Typically, we hear it from one 50s rock and roll singer, right?
Yeah, I said, "Baby Mercy," right?
Okay. For those of you who are younger, that man's name was Elvis Presley. Google him sometime. You'll find out all about him. When something goes well, we go, "Mercy, that was great," right? And on the flip side, when something goes horribly wrong, one of the first things we express is, "Lord, have mercy." We talk in church and Christian circles about grace and justice and mercy. And sometimes we look at those three words and we kind of get them confused. We're like, what does this mean? How are they different? How are they alike, right? Well, at some point, sometimes, someone smarter than myself, he defined these words this way. He said, grace is simply receiving what you don't deserve. Right? So getting something that you don't deserve, you haven't earned. Justice, well, that's getting exactly what you deserve. Okay? Right? You do a crime, you're found guilty of it, the statutes say the penalty for that crime is this, you receive that penalty, that is justice. You're getting what you deserve because of what you've done. Mercy, however, is not getting what you deserve. Not getting what you deserve. Mercy is Judge Capriol looking down at you from his bench and saying, "You don't owe the $400. I understand life has been hard. I take compassion on you. Go and don't do it anymore." And that is mercy. Throughout Scripture and in life, mercy takes on different meanings, is understood in different ways. Mercy is the word ahava, which refers to the love between a husband and wife. It is the word rahem, which is womb, and it refers to the maternal or the paternal love that God has for us as children. Mercy is hesed, steadfast loyalty, that God is steadfastly loyal to us, his people. But mercy is also understood as compassion, the showing of love, of care, of concern to one who is in need. And what we find is that the greatest example of mercy that God could have ever shown us comes to us in the form of a baby. Jesus. The birth of Christ. This time of year, what we're celebrating is the gift of mercy that God has given to us. And what we find is that we see that mercy expressed to us through Jesus in two ways. The first is that God fixes our greatest need, and then God meets our present need. First of all, God fixes our greatest need in that He provides us with salvation. Listen to these words from Peter. He says, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy." Okay? In His great mercy. Now He's going to list all these things. He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that's ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief and all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus is revealed. Though you've not seen Him, you love Him. And even though you do not see Him now, you believe in Him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you're receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your soul. All of that, he says, stems from the great mercy of God. So if mercy is not getting what you rightly deserve, we have to ask the question, what is it we deserve? And the ugly, hard to hear, difficult to comprehend, sometimes people say, that cannot possibly be, but the answer is, we deserve death. Going clear back to Adam and Eve. God looked at Adam. He said, Adam, you're in this garden, you've got everything here available for food, but there is one tree to stay away from. Okay? Don't eat from it. Because, Adam, if you eat from it, you're going to die. I don't know how God could have been any clearer. God was not beating around the bush. God said, Adam, eat from that tree, you're dead. We know the story. Adam and Eve ate from that tree. And even though they didn't immediately die, they eventually did. And when they died, when they ate from that tree, sin entered the world, death entered the world, the plan that God had for the world changed, and now everyone who is born into sin. As beautiful as those babies are, as lovely as all of you are, we are sin-filled. And Paul tells us in Romans that the wages of sin, right, or the consequences of sin, or the outcome of sin, is death. So you and I, who are sinners, deserve death. Now the interesting thing, or the tragic thing really, is that we as humans, we try to fix that. Right? We try to do things on our own to make that not so, to make us better, to make God like us in some way, right? That's in part why we look at ourselves as being beyond repair, because we've tried to fix ourselves and it hasn't worked. Right? We've bought the self-help book and realized that was a waste of money. We've done good deeds, but we still feel empty inside. We've worked and worked and worked until our strength has just given out and we can't seem to work anymore. We've put seemingly the right people in office, right? And that's failed miserably. We can't fix ourselves because we can't fix our greatest need. Just like in your home, when a pipe breaks, you call the plumber. When your car is broken, you take it to the mechanic. The broken soul needs a Savior. This is the mercy of God in Jesus at Christmas. He looked down upon us, trying to fix ourselves, reading the self-help book, right? Helping the old lady across the street, thinking that was going to make things right. And it didn't make us right. And instead of looking at us and saying, those guys are fools, I'm just going to go do something else, he had compassion on us. He had mercy on us. He literally said, I'm going to give them what they don't deserve. Now, you Sheldon Cooper fans out there, he didn't literally say that, okay? But Cooper Bang Theory fans, okay. I'm the only one who watched the most popular show in the history of television. Okay, anyway. He didn't give us, or he gave us what we did not deserve. And he looked down upon us trying to fix ourselves, and he gave us Jesus, and he said, this is what you need. And he said, I'm not just going to fix you. I'm not just going to repair what is broken. I'm going to make you new. I'm going to make you better than repair. I'm not going to put a patch on the tire. I'm going to give you a new tire. I come to make you new. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5, anyone who is in Christ, anyone who is a believer, anyone who follows Jesus, the old has gone, the brokenness has been removed, and the new has come. Christmas is the most wonderful time of year, not because of the presents. Christmas is the most wonderful time of the year because of the gift, Jesus, and that through Him, we can have salvation. In Him, we see what Zechariah referred to as the tender mercy of God. So, that's one way that we experience the mercy of God. The second way comes in God's compassion. That He looks down upon us with care and compassion and mercy in the here and now, in the right now, in the difficulties of this life, in the valley experiences, in the hurts and the pains and the difficulties of right now. God, in His compassion and His mercy, He gives us what we need to make it through. Matthew tells a story. He recounts a story that Jesus told, a parable that we know of as the unmerciful servant. In this parable, Jesus talks about a servant who owed what the new NIV says, and your translation may be something a little different, says he owed 10,000 bags of gold. Some have done the calculations to say that in today's economy, this dude owed like billions of dollars. Okay, that's billions with a B. Billions of dollars. We're talking about a culture in which he made a denarius a day. Suffice it to say, he was never going to pay back what he owed. And the master calls him in one day and says, hey, you owe me all this money. I need it, so I need you to pay me. And the servant says, I can't pay you right now, but I will pay you. I promise. I'll pay you. Just be patient with me. Have mercy on me. Knowing all the while he would never be able to pay it back. The master knew he would never be able to pay it back. And so the master looks down on him and says, okay. Jesus says he had compassion on the servant. And he forgave the debt. Billions of dollars the guy forgave, wiped clean. The servant left the master's presence. Now he's debt free. And then he sees a man who owes him like $20. And he goes up to the guy who owes him $20, and he says, hey, I need my money. Where's my money that you owe me? I want you to pay me right now. And the second servant goes, I don't have it, but I'll pay you. Trust me, I'll give you everything that you need, or that I owe you. And the first servant says, nope, not good enough, and he sends him to jail until he should pay back what he owes him. Now, there's other guys that are out in the street, and they see what goes on. And they knew what happened to the first servant. They knew that he had been forgiven billions of dollars. And so they go to the first master and they say, look, we're not trying to be tattletales, but you need to know what's going on. Here's what this dude did. The master calls the first servant back in and says, how can you be so unmerciful when I have been so merciful to you? And he throws him in jail, along with his whole family, until he should pay back what he owes. Basically, he gave him a life sentence in jail because he would never be able to pay back what he owed. In the story, we see the compassion and the mercy of God. God is the master who forgave the billions and billions in debt. This story shows, on one hand, how God has acted on our behalf in salvation, but also how he enters into our everyday lives and situations and trials. He is merciful to carry us when we can't walk and to support us when we're weak. He is merciful to provide for us when the bank account and the refrigerator are both empty. I remember in our church in Ohio, there were two men. Each of them owned a small business in our community. And each of them talked time and time again how they didn't see their business as their own, but they recognized that the business was God's, that he had blessed it to them, that he had given it to them, and they worked to make sure that he received the glory and they did his will through the business. And they recounted how times were, in the early of their business especially, that times got tough and they didn't have money to pay bills or to pay expenses or to pay salaries. And they simply prayed about it. And they asked God to provide and to do what God would do. And they said, God, this is your business. Do with it what you want. We're going to trust you. And they said, invariably, the next day, within the week, or a few days later, checks would come in the mail, and it would be in the amount that they needed to pay the bill or the expense or the salary or whatever it was. They trusted in the mercy of God. God's mercy is evident every day in our life if we would simply look for it. Your ability to push through another trying and difficult day, God has shown compassion to you. The deadline is extended, the relationship restored. You have joy in the midst of the loss. God's mercy is present. The mercy of God, His compassion, His love for you, it's on display everywhere we turn if we would simply open our eyes and look and embrace it in. Two takeaways for us. First, have you received the mercy of God? I know some of you might be here and you're wrestling with this God thing. You're wrestling with this Jesus person. You're wrestling with the church thing and Christianity, right? You've seen some believers and people who profess to be believers act in ways that you're like, how can I be a person that follows Jesus? And so you're wrestling with all this. I get it. You haven't embraced it yet. But what I want you to know is that the birth of Jesus, Christmas, is about a baby being born who lived a sinless life, who went to die on the cross, and who walked out of an empty grave, and he did it for you. But I want you to understand that this thing called Christianity, this thing called the church, is not about do's and don'ts. It's about someone who did something already. It's about something that is done on your behalf by one person and one person only that you need to be worried about, and that is Jesus. He is a gift for you and for me and for all of eternity. So have you recognized that in His mercy, God has given you Jesus, and Jesus you did not deserve. Jesus I did not deserve. He has made it possible for us to not just be beyond repair or to be fixed or to be patched. He's made it so that we can be new. Have you embraced that by choosing to follow Jesus, that baby born in Bethlehem, making Him Lord of your life? Because regardless of what else you have heard, and regardless of how ridiculous some of us look today, that is the purpose and the meaning of Christmas. That mercy has come to those who had no other option and no other choice. The second takeaway then is, if you've received this mercy, are you sharing it? Are you passing it on? If you've received it. What are you doing with this mercy that you have received, that has been lavished upon you? You see, the story of the unmerciful servant has another point to it, right? The first servant, he received this great amount of mercy, right? Billions of dollars, right? I'd like if someone just paid my mortgage. Billions of dollars in debt. And he goes out, and he hasn't embraced and received the mercy that was given to him, and for 20 measly dollars, he blows it, ruins it. He didn't pass it on. As followers of Christ, we should be people characterized as people of mercy. Why is it then that we seem to be known more for the things we hate than for our kindness and our gentleness and our grace and our love and our mercy? Ask anyone, or not anyone, but ask a lot of people who struggle with the church and with Christianity. And I'll bet you they're going to at least at some point say it's because they're bigoted or they hate or they don't love or they want it. In Luke chapter 6, verses 35 and 36, Jesus says this: "But love your enemies, do good to them, and lend to them without expecting to get anything back. Then your reward will be great, and you'll be children of the Most High, because He is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. Be merciful, just like your Father is merciful." Right? Jesus is saying, look, your Heavenly Father, God the Father, is kind to those who think differently than Him, to those who act differently than Him, to those that speak differently than Him, to those who have different lifestyles than He would have to them. He's still kind to them. Why aren't you? Why aren't I? He says you should be passing on the mercy that you have received even to those who are different and that you disagree with. Because your Father is merciful, you should be merciful as well. So if you've received the mercy of God into your life, you've got to pass it on. Years ago, a Salvation Army officer, his name was Captain Shaw, went to India as a medical missionary to a leper colony. As he walked in the first day, his eyes welled with tears because he saw these three prisoners who were shackled, wrists and ankles, and the shackles were cutting into their flesh that was covered and being destroyed by leprosy. Shaw had the chains removed from these men, and he took full responsibility for their actions should something happen, because remember, they were prisoners. And then he knelt before them, and he treated their hurting wrists and their ankles. About 2 weeks later, he had his first misgivings about setting them free, because he was asked to go on a trip overnight, and he was concerned about leaving his wife and child alone in the colony with these criminals who were not chained up. His wife insisted that she go, or that he go, saying she wasn't afraid that God would protect her. And so he left. The next morning, when Mrs. Shaw opened the door, she was startled to see the three criminals were lying on her porch. One explained, "We knew the doctor was gone, and so we stayed here all night so that no harm would come to you." God is a God of mercy who has shown us great mercy. And He did it in the form of Jesus, someone we did not deserve. In a sense, He sent Jesus to lay at our door, to protect us and to provide for us what we could not provide ourselves. Jesus is an act of love, an act of compassion. He is an act of mercy given to us by the God of our mercy. Let's pray. Father God, we are grateful for Jesus. We are humbled that You would love us so much and find us so valuable and worthy that You would give Him to us, giving us something that we do not, or are not giving us something that we do deserve. That through Him, death can be removed, life and hope. taking its place. And so, Father, I pray that in the midst of all of our Christmas celebrations and time with families and buying gifts and sharing gifts and all that stuff, I pray we have fun with that. But I pray the foundation of our lives, the foundation of this season, is the celebration of the birth of Jesus, the gift of mercy given to us by the God of mercy.